Holy is Lord. voices in song and prayer, aware of his closeness as we are gathered two or more in his name. The scripture readings for Mass today are found in the bulletin that was distributed as you walked in. As we gather to worship as the family of St. Columbanus, please stand as we begin our liturgy with a song from our music ministers.
Be with us. We recognize that it's this gift of God's mercy that keeps us going through this journey of life. And even in the moments when you and I fall short, even in the times that we fall into the ways of sin, God continues to share the gifts of mercy and forgiveness with each of us. And so as we prepare to celebrate the sacred mysteries, we first pause to call to mind our sins and to ask again for God's pardon and peace.
From the book of the prophet Isaiah. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call him while he is near. Let the scoundrel forsake his way, and the wicked his thoughts. Let him turn to the Lord for mercy, to our God, who is generous and forgiving. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways are my ways, says the Lord. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are my ways above your ways, and my thoughts above your thoughts. The word of the Lord.
Oh. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus.
to hold Jesus in our hands. That we're called to hold on to Jesus no matter what it is that we have to face. And the reason why I wanted us to think about it over the course of this week is because we prayed together last Sunday that whatever it is that we walked into church with, whatever it was that we were holding on to, the invitation was for us to lay it down, to leave it here in this place. To hold on to Jesus is to be reminded what St. Paul says to the Philippians in chapter 4 and verse 13, that I can broken relationships happen, and bankruptcies happen, and addictions happen, and self-doubt begins to happen. And there's all sorts of things that happen in our life that when we set out on the journey, we have great plans, grand plans for the way that our life is going to look. And then what happens is life happens. But we get all sorts of challenges. We face all sorts of difficulties. There's all sorts of bumps along the way that causes us to reevaluate and causes us to question what the plans are that we have for ourselves, what it is that God is trying to do in our lives at this moment. And if you never had that happen to you before, welcome to 2020. That's what this entire year has been like for every single one of us. I mean, when we gather here in this church for our watch night service back in January, we had great plans of what 2020 was going to look like. And then in the first months of this year, we lost a number of our parishioners day after day and week after week. We celebrated funeral after funeral here in our church all throughout January and February and March. Then we found ourselves staying at home. We couldn't be here together to worship. We find ourselves in the midst of a political season that is tumultuous, a political season that all of us want to be over on November 3rd. And it feels like when things can't get worse, all sorts of worse happens. It's this lack of faith that reminds us each and every day that we have to let go. We have to let go of having control. We have to let go of what it is that we plan for ourselves. We have to let go in the moments when things don't go our ways. And look, it's not to say that we're called to be a people who give up. We're not called to be a people who throw in the towel. We're not called to be a people who think that we have been defeated. But instead, in our life as Christians, as followers of Jesus, our letting go is what allows God's plans for our lives to really take root. It's when we let go that you and I are able to actually walk into our calling, that you and I are able to begin to live in the way that God is truly calling us to live. Even, and maybe most especially, when none of it makes sense. See, that's what the prophet Isaiah is saying in chapter 55, starting in verse 6. The first reading begins by reminding us that you and I have the power to call on the Lord when He is near. And in our suffering, in our difficulties, in life's journey, our God is the one who always desires to be near to us. This God who desires to come and dwell among us, what we read about in the Gospel of John, chapter 3 and verse 16, that for God so loved the world that He sent His only begotten Son. That this God, the God who's created the heavens and the earth, is the God who desires to be like us. The creator of the heavens and the earth, the God who sits high and yet still when we wake up feeling like there's no point, and questioning what it is that God is doing, and why it is that God seems to keep throwing so much stuff upon us. That's our thinking. But as Isaiah reminds us, God's plans for you and for me and for us as a parish are greater than what we can plan for ourselves. And God's thinking is so far beyond what you and I can ever come to understand in this life. That our life of growing in love and our life of deepening our relationship with God is all about our willingness to let go. To let go. To let go so that God can truly come into our lives and transform everything about us. It means that we have to move beyond what's comfortable in our lives so that we can be in a position to receive our call. I think that's what it means to let go. That if we want to have an encounter with Jesus that promises to change and transform everything about our lives, we have to be willing to abandon ourselves so that God's work and God's will might be fulfilled in our lives. Go back to the book of Exodus in chapter 3 and chapter 4 and read again the story of Moses. I'm sure all of you remember the story of Moses, amen? That Moses encounters the Lord there in the burning bush. Then in chapter 3 of Exodus, as Moses is before the burning bush, he's filled with great fear and great awe. He recognizes that he stands in the presence of the Lord. And even with that recognition of knowing that he was in the presence of the Lord, he wasn't quite willing to accept the calling that God was asking. Five times, Moses was asked to deliver a message to Pharaoh to bring freedom to the people of Israel. And five times Moses had an excuse as to why it couldn't be him. He wasn't a good speaker. It should be somebody else. What if nobody was to believe me? Moses came up with excuse after excuse. And yet, he finally got to a place of being willing to accept what the Lord was calling him to. He was finally willing to let go of all of his excuses so that he could bring the message to Pharaoh that said that you should let my people go. Go to the book of Ruth in the Old Testament and hear the story of this young woman who becomes the widow, the daughter-in-law and sister-in-law of other widows. In chapter 1 in verse 18, Ruth says to Naomi, "Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you lodge, I will lodge. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God." That even as Ruth had this opportunity to return to her family and to return to her former way of life, she was willing to let go of all of that to trust in what the Lord was calling her to do. It's because she was willing to let go that she would eventually become the wife of Boaz. And from Boaz, in the lineage, comes David. And from David comes Jesus. That it was because of her willingness to let go that Ruth becomes a part of this great lineage of Jesus' story. Think about the apostles, those first believers, that as they stood there on the seashore and they heard Jesus say to them, "Come, follow me," they had to be willing to let go of their boats, their nets, their families, their livelihood, the way of life that they had, trusting in the call that Jesus placed upon their life. It was when they were willing to let go of all of that that Jesus brought them to a place of being able to heal the sick and to raise the dead, that Jesus was able to use them to bring about new life in this world. Think about Jesus as he was there in the Garden of Gethsemane, that even as his own suffering and death was impending, he still recognized that it wasn't his will that was to be done, but the Father's in heaven. And even the first communities of faith, the people in Corinth and in Ephesus and in Rome, the people like Titus and Timothy, the ones that Peter and Paul were writing to, they were willing to let go of their very life. They were willing to die for the sake of the gospel. They were willing to let go of everything that they had so that you and I could be here 2,000 years later to hear the good news again that Jesus Christ is alive. And even But when we're holding on to our past, and when we're too afraid to let go of our own plans, and we're too afraid to let go of what it is that we want for our lives, and when we're too afraid to let go so that we can let God move into our lives, we're never going to find our peace. We're never going to find our joy. And we're never going to fulfill the mission of our lives. So we have to be here. We need to be in worship with one another today. We need to gather around this altar, whether we're here in this sanctuary or watching at home on Facebook. We need to be here so that we can be reminded of what's possible in our lives. So that we can become a little bit more like Moses and a little bit more like Ruth and a little bit more like the apostles and a little bit more like the first believers and a little bit more like Jesus. To understand that God's ways are not our ways. And God's time is not our time. And God's thinking is not our thinking. But the more we walk with Jesus, the more that we come to know God, the more we'll trust and believe that we can let go. That we can let go of everything that holds us back. So that God can fulfill the mission that He's called us and created us for. So, church, let go.
Stop worrying.
Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there, He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. We can have the faith and the strength to let go, because we know that God hears us, that God knows the innermost parts of ourselves. We trust and believe that God is the one with the power to hear us and to answer us. So with faith and hope, we bring our prayers and needs before our loving God.
The response is, Lord, hear our prayer. For the church, that we may strive always to conduct ourselves in a way worthy of the gospel of Christ. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our
prayer. For political leaders at every level, that they may be compassionate to those who are most vulnerable, to those who have been overlooked or forgotten. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear
our prayer. For those who work in fields, on farms, and in vineyards, harvesting the food we eat, that they may be rewarded generously for their labor. We pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for our Jewish friends and neighbors, whose celebration of Rosh Hashanah, the new year, ends Sunday, today, we pray to the Lord.
Lord,
that our parish community may invite and welcome others at all times with the generosity modeled by the land of God in today's gospel. We pray to the Lord.
Lord,
we pray that the planet's resources will not be plundered, but shared in a just and respectful manner. We pray to the Lord.
Lord,
and as we take a moment to think about our own intentions, please offer a moment of silence. For all of the prayers on our hearts and for all of the prayers shared with our community, we pray to the Lord.
Lord,
as we gather our disciples, we remember in a special way one of our parishioners, Ben Paul Pope to the Lord, who passed away some months ago, Luz Mizminda Estores. As we celebrate her birthday this weekend, we remember her and we pray for her family who are gathered with us. We ask God to continue to grant them the gift of comfort and peace. We pray to the Lord. Most gracious and loving God, we truly give you thanks and praise this day. We thank you, God, for the blessings that you continue to shower upon us. We thank you prayers that you answer. We thank you, Lord, for the gift of your Spirit that strengthens us to let go. And so we ask you, Lord, to continue to move into our hearts, into our lives, into our spirits, so that we might always be willing to say yes to you. We thank you, God, for the plans that you have for each of us. We just ask you in this moment to open our hearts so that we might be willing to trust in what you are trying to do. As we pray together in Christ our Lord. So before in preparing the altar, you know, you have opportunities to give your text, to give your Sunday offertory. You can place it there in the container that's at the door, front door of the church. You can always visit our parish website and click on ways to give. But I just want to again say thank you. At our staff meeting we had just about a week ago, we ran the numbers of what March or September of 2019 looked like versus March, September 15th of 2020. And so far, because of all of you and because of our generosity as a parish, we've collected 98% of our anticipated offerings for this year. It means that when the month of September ends, our collection this year between March and September in the midst of the pandemic will be more than it was in 2019. Between March and September this year, we raised $75,000 to support the work of our food pantry here in St. Palamedes, which is 33% higher than it was last year at the same time, and we have an increase of 66% in online giving. So to all of you, we'll continue to make our mission and our ministry responsible at St. Palamedes, I say thank you. It's because of all of us together, trusting in what God has called us to do, sacrificing for what God gives us, that we are able to plant seeds into the ministries of our church. So thank you for your gift, thank you for your generosity.
We're gonna go back to my grandmother's song, I'll sing it across.
the Lord, we pray, the offerings of your people, that what they profess with devotion and faith may be theirs through these heavenly mysteries, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you laid the foundations of the world and have arranged the changing of times and seasons. You formed man and woman in your own image and set humanity over the whole world in all its wonder, to rule in your name over all you have made, and forever praise you in your mighty works, through Christ our Lord. And so with all the angels, we praise you as a joyful celebration we acclaim.
Light your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that
that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with St. Columbanus, the apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, for every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus, who said to your apostles, "Peace I give you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. May the peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Know that those have those priests to walk with them at their journey of life. So thank you so much for allowing your name to perish for these years. And please pray for me, though I'm always praying for you.
Wait for us.